Hey everyone, and welcome to Dinner Rolls and
Convo.
Yes, tonight I made some chicken cheese steak sliders and french fries, and my husband was like, you know, don't put no cheese in it. And I'm like, you can't have a cheese steak without no cheese.
I'm glad she did. It tastes just like back home.
Thank you. Found it, dude.
You did your thing. I was trying to think of something smart to say, and I can't.
And usually he does always have something to say. Jokingly. But anyway, this is our first episode of doing Dinner Rolls and Convo. And this episode is about the difference between staying through adversity and staying with immoral behavior. So I recently did a blog, and I wanted to go a little deeper into what adversity is versus what immoral behavior is. And before we jump into it, I just want to say that if you're with somebody that is challenging your integrity, if you're loving somebody trying to stay through something that is challenging your integrity, I feel like that is a dangerous kind of love. And at the end of the day, it's not really love. It's a lust that you're holding on to, because I feel like true love is not going to make you do things that you wouldn't normally do, challenge your values, your morals, your beliefs, and things of that sort.
Yeah, real love will always make you a better version of yourself.
I like that. Do I make you a better version?
Yes. Like, I think I said it on previous episodes, how when you go to do wrong, you'll always think of that person.
Right.
Your mate. You know, thing like, what? How is this affecting this person?
Right.
Like, am I affecting this person in a negative way?
Right.
Will this hurt my spouse?
Right.
Or my girlfriend, woman, whatever you have.
And I was recently working on like a relationship ebook for relationship stress, and one of the topics is finances. And I, you know, to piggyback on that, you'll never create a debt without your partner knowing, because that will affect them negatively. Right. That will impact them just as much as it will impact you.
Right.
So let's look at what immoral behavior is. So it's a long list for me, but I think having multiple spouses is immoral behavior. Because to me, I feel like, you know, we're Christians, we go by the Bible, and I feel like there's so much in the Bible that people don't follow, and then they wonder why their relationship is not working out the way that it should be. Yeah. And I think about Sarah. When she, you know, you know all that happened when she involved her handmaid.
Right. Like, she tried to bring a third party in, which was unnecessary. God's promise is God's promise.
Right.
He made a promise to Abraham. Regardless of what Sarah thought of herself, regardless of how old she thought she was, or the fact that she might have been trying her whole life, the promise of God overruled all that.
Right.
And that's all she had to depend on, was the promise of God. And because she brought in this third party, her handmaid, she had to go through so much. And the children of Hagar are some of the same people we have problems with to this day.
That's deep. I love when you talk biblical. No, but then you have, you know, tying into, because I feel like if you can have multiple spouses, you know, that's, or not multiple spouses, but want to have multiple women or multiple men, that's tying into habitual lying.
Right.
And to me, that's immoral behavior, because like you said in the beginning, when you're in a relationship with somebody, you don't do anything to harm them. You're constantly thinking of what is going to impact them. And I feel like habitually, and what I mean by habitual lying is just like constant lying over and over again. And if you're a cheater, you're a liar, because you're lying to your spouse, unless you're in an open relationship, which is no good anyway.
Right, and you're lying to yourself too.
Right.
Like bringing in a third party, like why? There has to be some level of unhappiness that you're feeling with your spouse.
Yeah.
Exactly. So that's kind of like disrespect. How do you even present that?
yeah,
to your spouse. Like, and then the spouse agree with it, because it's like, if you're telling me you want to experience something with somebody else, that means you're not enjoying the experience that we're having together.
Exactly.
Why do you want more? Let me know what you need. Let me know what I'm doing wrong, so I can possibly fill that void. Because it's only bad things going to come when you bring somebody else in.
Yeah.
Feelings are going to go the other way. I always say that's part of my wedding spiel when I do weddings, when I marry people. Learn to turn inward in times of difficulty.
Yes.
Turn inward. Don't start looking. The grass is not always greener on the other side.
And that's where communication is really important. And that's where immoral behaviors happen, because you're not communicating. It's okay to say to your partner, hey, you know what? I'm lacking. I need you to be a little bit more affectionate towards me.
Right.
You know, I need you to show me a little bit love, because I think about in the beginning, you weren't touchy-feely like that. You know what I'm saying? You just became that over time because you realized that that's what I like. I like for you to just hug up on me, hold my hand. You know, I don't like PDA as much as I did back then, but but, you know, you get the picture as far as, you know, that's concerned.
And I feel as if your soulmate or the person that's really meant for you will always understand the issues that you're having. Mm-hmm. Like if we have an issue, if I have an issue with you, and I've noticed this about you. If I say something to you that I have a problem, I'll notice that you'll start to correct it.
Yeah.
You'll do the things that, you know what I mean, is taken to correct that.
And
we
just had this conversation the other day just about being patient.
Right.
And that's, again, another thing that causes immoral behavior to happen, is you don't lack patience. If you or your partner may be weak in one area, you have to be patient with that person. Nothing is going to happen overnight. We just had this conversation the other day. And so I think that's really important. It's a lot of things that cause immoral behavior other than just the fact that somebody wants to cheat or somebody, there's a reason behind everything that somebody does. And it could just be because they're a scumbag.
Right.
You know, maybe, because I feel like everybody that is married, everybody that's in a relationship is not meant to be married or in a relationship. And that's okay.
Right.
That's okay to me. I would rather you stay single than to get into a relationship. You're not doing what you're supposed to be doing. You're making your spouse do something that they don't feel comfortable doing or they're not supposed to be doing. And then you just have a ball of issues.
Right.
For no reason.
Yeah, it's like what we talked about immoral behavior, about your upbringings. You have to understand, one, how your spouse or significant other was brought up.
Right.
And then the things that happened to them growing up. That's what we talked about with R. Kelly.
Yeah.
Like,
right.
There are so many people that were molested and abused and suffered verbal abuse that's all they know.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it makes people, like, immoral behavior is, like, embedded in them. And it just comes out.
Right. And I think about, you know, going back to, you know, the R. Kelly situation, just abuse in general. And abuse in physical, verbal, emotional, mental, all of it to me is all in one.
Right.
Immoral behavior. I think about, you know, people always think like physical abuse, like hitting and punching is the worst.
Right.
But to me, I don't want verbal abuse.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's a possibility. Now, I don't want to get punched or, you know, hit.
Right.
Disclaimer.
Right.
However, it's a possibility that my wounds will heal.
Right.
But when you verbally abuse somebody, you know, that lasts a lifetime.
Right.
I think Maya Angelou, that's my girl, she said people will remember how you made them feel.
Right.
And that's what verbal abuse is, just constantly attacking somebody or berating them or making them feel like, you know, they aren't worth anything or that they are nothing.
Right. One of the most sensitive parts of the body is the brain, the mind. The body will heal in time, but the mind, that's why the devil always attacks the mind.
That's true.
Because it's the weakest part. Once he attacks that, once he has that, it will spill over into other relationships.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I can't be happy here, and even though my next person may be a good man or a good woman, man, I'm going to take it out on them.
Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's why now relationships are failing when you get into a new relationship, because people are so quick to jump from relationship to relationship without doing the proper healing. So if you were affected by a person from a previous relationship, give yourself time to heal. Give yourself time to get yourself together and get back to who you were. Or even if you don't know yourself, get to know yourself. Right. But if you constantly jump, you know, like in high school, I always had to have a boyfriend. I just go pick somebody out and say, hey, you know, when we were split up, just because I felt like, again, there's a reason for that, and I won't get into the reason, but you always feel like you have to have somebody. And I think I posted a few weeks ago, a relationship will not give you peace. A relationship will not make you whole. You have to do that work internally for yourself. And then we also hit on earlier about making a moral behavior, making your boyfriend, girlfriend, fiance, husband, wife do sexual acts. And we learned that allegedly, gotta say allegedly, in the R. Kelly case, where I think one of his new ex-girlfriends just came out and said that he made them do degrading sex acts.
Right.
And I feel like that's definitely immoral if you are embarrassed.
Right.
To, you know, not that you go around talking about your sex life, but we have sex. I'm not embarrassed to say that.
Right.
Now, if we're bringing somebody in, definitely I would be embarrassed to say that.
Right.
Never happened. But you typically are embarrassed to say those things. And I feel like that's definitely something that, again, going back to the Bible, that's not what God intended for a marriage to be. Right. Just because of all the problems that it caused.
And I look at, like, immoral behaviors in the bedroom as far as, you know how I am about not wanting you to inflict any type of pain on you.
So annoying.
You could ask me, like, to scratch your back, and
it's
I won't even want to do it too
so
hard.
Annoying. Because, man, I think that's the way we're getting out of it.
There is no way I would want to make you feel uncomfortable in any type of way. So I think it's the same thing when it comes to sex or any type of other, you know what I mean? Anything, period. There is no way I want to make you feel uncomfortable. And there is no way if I love you, I will force you to do uncomfortable. Because why would that give me pleasure?
Right.
That should be a red flag.
Right.
If somebody's taking pleasure in my pain, that's a red flag to me. Mm-hmm. There is no way I'll be able to have pleasure if I know I'm causing you pain.
Right. Right. Again, that's part of just loving who you are with.
Right.
Truly loving. Because there's a lot of people that have this lip love, but they don't really show it through their actions or their behaviors.
Right.
It's just, you know, I'm going to tell this person what they want to hear, when they want to hear it, because I know that's what they will accept.
Right.
And that's why you have to be strong. Because people can weed out weak people and they'll prey on you. If you give them one inkling that you are weak, boom, you sucked up into their, you know, and that's what they said R. Kelly allegedly did as far as pick out teenagers or women, grown women that actually went through something to cause them to be weak in whatever capacity, you know. So you have to be confident in who you are. You have to be strong. You have to know you,
right.
Period.
Right. Confidence is really important in a relationship. Mm-hmm.
Definitely think so. So I think, you know, as far as immoral behavior, I just, to sum that part up, it's just all about, to me, what is challenging your integrity.
Right.
What is challenging your integrity? If you are in a relationship where your integrity, which is your morals, your values, your honesty, your truth is being jeopardized, or you feel like it's being question or challenge of any kind, you're definitely in a situation of where, you know, it's not good, it's not healthy, it's going to lead down the dark path.
Always choose God first. And when you choose God first, if you feel as if somebody's trying to get you to do something that's contrary to what you think God will be pleased with, and you know what I mean, it ain't happening over here.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, God comes first. I want God to be pleased
right.
with me, even before I want you to be pleased
right.
with me. I want the Lord to be pleased with me.
And I think I think people stay through immoral behavior for a second. We'll get to that later. But to get to that, we have to understand what regular adversity is. So that's like your typical woes. What can you expect to happen in a relationship? What is normal adversity to go through that you, because I feel like God didn't intend for us to, you know, we're supposed to have compassion and patience and all that good stuff, but I don't think he would approve of immoral behavior. And I don't think, because of that, I don't think it's something that you have to tolerate. If it's challenging, if it's in the Bible to do X and you're doing Y,
right,
you're automatically wrong.
Right.
You know, so to me, that's intolerable if it's going against what you believe.
Right.
And so, go ahead.
God is too wise to make a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't speak. Once he speaks, that's it. So anything that you're trying to get me to do that's contrary to what he said do, and we got a problem.
Absolutely. So let's look at, talk about like regular adversity. To me, I always think like you can expect to have disagreements.
Right.
That's just naturally going to happen just because me and you, we are soulmates. We are like-minded in certain ways, but we're not alike.
Right.
We think kind of differently on certain things. And so you're going to have disagreements of, hey, you know, you might want to think about it this way, you know, and then it's going to be a debate. It's going to be a conversation. And I think, you know, our generation, we're so quick to just get up and exit because, oh, we had a disagreement.
Right.
Well, you're going to be getting up from every relationship.
Right.
It's like going to work. You don't always agree with your boss.
Right.
But do you get up and quit?
Right.
Every single time you don't agree with them?
It's like the minor adversities are the things that make you stronger as a couple. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, if I'm doing something a certain way and you can see that it's wrong,
mm-hmm,
and you not correct me and just let me keep going wrong, I mean, we're not going to grow from that.
Right.
It's not going to be no improvement on my end and us as a couple.
Right.
It's like Lonzo Ball. When he first came to the league, he had that weird jump shot. And although he made some of them, he made it to the NBA. It was good enough to make to the NBA. But at the end of the day, somebody had to come and be like, look, man, if you want to take it to the next level, mm-hmm, this is what you need to do.
Right.
And if he wanted to improve, then he had to make the necessary corrections, right, to improve.
Right.
And if you keep telling me that I need to improve in a certain aspect, I need to look at it close. And because I know you love me,
right,
and it's only gonna come from, I mean, it's coming from love. It's, mm-hmm, like, it's all right, it's not a hater,
yeah, all right,
you know what I mean? Lonzo Ball's coach is not a hater,
right,
he wants to win,
right?
So he's gonna give him good advice,
right?
And you want to win in our relationship,
right?
So if you see me doing something wrong, that correction is for my betterment, our betterment,
right? And I think of, you know, a lot of our, maybe about 60% of our relationship problems, the other 40% might be half and half. I think to me, and you could possibly think something different, a percentage of our relationship problems came from immaturity because we got married so young.
Right.
You know, I was 18 years old. I was a baby. I didn't know anything. Right. Thought I was grown, but didn't. I wasn't really grown.
Right.
And so it came from immaturity, and then it came, from finances. And I think immaturity is definitely something that you grow out of,
right,
as you grow up. You know, especially when you're in a situation as to where you are in a relationship young.
Right.
Naturally, you don't think the way that you think at 18, 19, 20, 21 as you do when you get into your 30s or when you get, right, into your 40s. And so I think that's normal to go through. And I actually have an online workshop coming out soon about how to deal with that, how to not outgrow your partner. Because it is a question that I get a lot, you know, from our relationship. You know, how can you be married almost 14 years? How could you have been with this person for 17 years and not have outgrown each other?
Right.
And so I think maturity is definitely something that you can work through.
Right. even with all the trials and tribulations that we went through as a couple, like, I do not discourage people in getting married young. I just tell them that there are things that you're going to go through that an older couple may not go through.
Right.
As far as, like, it's a culture shock, even for a single person. When you move out of your parents' house and suddenly, boom, you have to do everything on your own. Even though I was 21 when we got married, I still, like, I didn't have the experience behind me as far as doing everything on my own. I lived with my parents until I was 18, and then I lived in a house that was belonged to my dad, and he wasn't even charging me rent, you know. And I lived with my brother.
Baby.
And I lived with my brother, and he was charging me rent, but I wasn't even paying it, so...
So spoiled. I truly, now I know to blame your parents and your siblings for what I'm doing. You're spoiled. You're so spoiled. You're so spoiled.
I remember my dad, my siblings confronted my dad about me being spoiled. And my dad said he didn't spoil on God's spoil. So, hey. God did. Blame God.
You suffer from... baby syndrome, the youngest child baby syndrome. No, but seriously, to me, that's something that you can grow out of. If you truly love somebody, and I knew for a fact, no matter what we went through, of course I got weak, you know, because I was young. I didn't know how to deal with conflict. Of course I got weak along the way, but I definitely think that maturity is something you can work through. It's not something that's intolerable or immoral. It never questioned my integrity. It's just growing pains, as I like to call them. And I also think, like, imperfection. And we talked about this the other day where, you know, I felt, like, pressure all my life to be perfect. And I really, you know, I apologized to you the other day because I felt like I projected perfection onto you. Like, you can't make any mistakes. You have to do this. You have to do that. You're leaving. You know, and I didn't realize how I grew up provoked all of that because I expect perfection from myself. Right. And my cousin, you know, she had to tell me the other day, shout out to Star. She's gonna get pissed because I called her that, but whatever. You know, she told me, you have to realize that you're not perfect. You're going to make mistakes. Don't beat yourself up about it. Just move on. It is what it is.
Right.
But it's because that I felt pressure to be perfect every single time. And I projected that onto you. And I feel like imperfection is definitely can turn into adversity in your relationship. And it could possibly ruin your relationship if you don't check it.
Right.
And I don't necessarily think it's immoral, but it can ruin your relationship if you don't check it at the door.
Right. And you know my saying. My saying is...
Or perfection, not imperfection.
Shoot for the moon. If you miss... You'll still be amongst the stars. You'll still be on higher ground. You always strive for perfection.
Right.
Seek perfection. Hope for perfection. Expect perfection. Well, I don't say expect it, but you know what I mean.
Yeah.
But if you don't get it, don't let it be a deal breaker. Right. Or don't criticize anybody else because they're not perfect.
Right.
Strive for it, because if you strive for it, the closer you get to it, the better off you'll be. You may never get to perfection, but if you get close enough, you know what I mean? You'll still be in a better position.
Nobody's ever going to be A1.
Right.
Through everything, you know.
Right.
You might be strong in one area, but you're never going to be A1 in all areas of your life.
Right.
And that's just facts. And I think something that you can expect in your relationship that's adversity that you can work through is just like small annoyances, like, you know, leaving clothes on the ground or leaving dishes around. You know, stuff like that, to me, that's minimal.
Right.
You know, that has nothing to do with your integrity. That's just little things that, hey, we got to work together as a team now. Let's figure out, you know, we both live here. We both want to clean the house. Let's, you know, figure out how we're going to do this. And I feel like that's something that a lot of people, especially older women that have never been married, because they're so set in their ways. They're so used to doing things how they want it done for so many years, but they just dated here and there, that these small things that are really small things,
right,
it doesn't matter.
Right.
Or it matters to them. Whereas when you're a veteran couple, that stuff doesn't phase you. It's just like, whatever, I'll pick up, you know, because you could attest to, I don't harass you about stuff like that. You know, I don't harass, you don't harass me, you know, so it's just like, you know, if you leave something around, you just pick it up and keep it pressing, right. Keep it moving. And I think that's something that people get confused because people tend to be so selfish. I think that's what it all boils down to when dealing with adversity. It's just like, we just want to get up because this person is not doing what we want them to do at this hour that they're doing it, when they're doing it. You know, it's just...
Yeah, you can't let a small thing spoil your peace. Well, there's nothing more valuable than having peace in your home. Nothing more valuable than
that. That's the whole word right there. Nothing more valuable than having peace. I think going into that, you know, there's a reason why people confuse the two. You know, why do people choose to stay through immoral behavior instead of, you know, being with somebody that is going to love them, protect them, guide them, be a true leader in their household? Not perfect, but be a true leader in the household. And that's, you know, providing, protecting, all of that. It has nothing to do with perfection, but are you going to make me feel safe and secure in my home?
Right.
You know, and I feel like people confuse the two and stay through immoral behavior is a lot of it is self-esteem issues.
Right.
People don't have self-worth, and that goes back to what we were saying earlier about just when you, not to jump from relationship to relationship, heal yourself, learn yourself, be confident in yourself to prevent self-worth issues, self-esteem issues.
You gotta be patient and you have to know your worth.
Yeah. And you know, a lot of people will accept anything because they feel like that's what they deserve.
Right.
You know, I'm going to mess with a drug dealer, even though I know that this person could possibly put me, I could end up in jail, you know, somebody could come by the house and shoot the house up, right. But this is what I deserve, so this is what I'm going to go after.
Right. A lot of the red flags that you see are not coincidences. Yeah. A lot of times they're signs from God.
Yeah.
And we always want God to show us a sign, but yet when he shows them to it, we ignore him.
Right. It's like, you know, and that goes into my second point is why people, you know, do that. Because people think that they can change this person.
Right.
You can't change nobody.
Right.
That change has to be internal.
Right.
You know, that change has to be wanted by the person.
Right.
Because if it's not, it's going to frustrate you. And then it's going to frustrate them.
Right.
And then you'll get mad because the change is not going to be consistent.
Right.
It's not going to be permanent. So then you're going to be all upset and flustered. But you force this person to change.
Right.
You're making this person be something that they're not.
Right.
And that will not work.
It's a classic Tyler Perry movie. Man beating up on his wife and he apologized to her. Saying he's never going to do it again. He's sorry. This and that. I love you. Next argument, boom, he's beating her up again.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not just a Tyler Perry movie, that's reality.
Yeah.
It's happening every day.
And that's like, you know, your clock ticking.
Right. Abuse is another immoral behavior. It's not just sexual.
Mm-hmm.
Physical abuse, like, there's no reason to stay with that. I don't care if you have kids and they're about to graduate and you don't want to bring them through another school district and all this. No. Because not only are you doing damage to yourself, but you're doing damage to that child. How many kids abuse their spouses because that's what they saw growing up?
Right.
This is the example I saw. This is how I saw a man is supposed to treat a woman. Degrade her, beat her, treat her like she's nothing.
Right.
So I'm going to do the same thing to you.
Right. And it is generational, because you see pop-pops that pass it on to their kids, and then their kids pass it on to the other kids, and then it's just a triple, a generational curse of, you know, well, pop-pop did it, so, you know.
Exactly. That's the worst thing you can do for a child is not lead by example.
Yes.
Because when a child sees you do it, how can you tell me not to do it? That's the reason a lot of people don't go to certain churches. Mm-hmm. Because the preacher is up there preaching one thing, and yet we know you're living another way. Mm-hmm. As a parent, how can I tell my child, don't do this, don't do that? And then in their plain sight, I'm doing the very thing that I'm telling them not to do.
Right.
They won't respect my word.
Right.
If they can't respect my actions.
Right. And all I can say for, you know, women, because naturally men, you know, they don't care. They can produce at any age, you know, for the most part at any age. So for men, I don't feel like they say, oh, my clock is ticking, I gotta get married. But women, you know, all I can say to you about that is, don't rush time,
right?
You know, because rush results is not going to get you to where you are trying to be, right, where you desire to be. So if you have the mindset of 42, I need to get married, you know, that's a lot of the times where you pick the wrong people because you're so hell bent on just being in a relationship. I want to be in this relationship. My clock is ticking. I need to have kids. I need to do this. I need to do that. And you're not thinking. Your judgment is clouded. So you have to remove all that. I want to say let God. But you have to allow God to have his way in your life. You know, you can't focus on that. And I tell people all the time is, if you start putting focus on other things other than God or putting stuff above him, you know, you're asking for a whole lot of trouble.
Can't serve two masters. Mm. You're going to love one and hate the other.
Right.
And a master is not just somebody that stands over you with a whip.
Right.
Your money can be your master. Your job can be your master. Your spouse can be your master.
Right.
God has to come first. It has to be an order. God is first. Then we'll go from there. But God has to be first. You cannot put anything
right
above God.
And I think too, also, people just like the idea of being in a relationship, to say that they're with this person, and so that's why they stay through intolerable and immoral behavior, you know, because it's just like, well, I'm content, I'm happy, which is really not content, you're just complacent,
right,
you know. And you're not really, again, your judgment is clouded because all you're concerned about is the benefits of what this person can do for you.
Right.
What this person has done for you instead of all the damage that they have already done to you or currently doing to you.
Right.
And I think that is a disaster of a relationship.
Right.
You know, at the end of the day, I don't want temporary happiness. I want a happiness that is going to last. I want a happiness that we've been married 14 years July, okay? So in another 20 years, I want to still feel the same way I do now.
Right.
You know, I still want to love up on you and, you know, me bang earphones on you if you call me a troll. Like that earlier, that literally happened earlier today. I did troll him by banging earphones on him. It was soft. It wasn't like a real bang. But you know, I want to have that playful mentality. I don't want to just be in a relationship just to say I've been married for, what did I say, 34 years.
Right.
I don't want to do that. I don't want to be complacent.
Right.
I want this love and our love to continue to grow. And I hope to help other people want the same thing.
Right.
What's the point of being in a relationship if you're not going to grow happily?
Right. And my thing is, I always want to live in the now. It's natural to have goals as a couple, and you should have goals and you should strive for goals. But I want you to be happy right now.
Right.
Because as we saw last Sunday,
yes,
every time I walk out that door,
yes,
it's no guarantee that I'm coming back. And I leave that in my mind every day. That if I die today, would my wife be content? I know she's going to be sorrowful. I know she's going to be sad. But is she going to be like, man, I had a good husband.
Yeah.
I enjoyed my life while I was here. While he was here. Because it's like, I look at some marriages and I look at how some people die. And it's just like, you find out at the funeral that this guy had a whole nother family, and it's just like they look back on their lives and like, man, like I wasted so many years. And I never want you to have that feeling when I die that you wasted time. I want you to be satisfied and content with the life that we shared together.
And there's also people, you know, that I always say, I just posted this actually a few weeks ago, quality over quantity. You know, there's a lot of people that have been married 30, 40, 50 years, but they have cheated on their spouse,
right.
You know, or they're currently cheating on their spouse. And to me, that's no way to live.
Right.
I don't want to live my years where I'm supposed to just be enjoying life, kicking back, you know, doing something like that. And you know, for our generation, in order to get to that point, you have to put in the work now.
Right.
You have to do what it takes now. You have to nurture your relationship now. And you nurture by recognizing what adversity is versus what immoral behavior is. You don't have to stay through the BS. Stay through regular adversity that you can work through, that you can grow through. Things that I look at our adversity, our financial issues, our immaturity that we went through, and I look at it all as a lesson.
Right.
You know, I just did a blog, My Greatest Influence. It's not who, but it was what, and it was my marital struggles because of all that I experienced in those marital struggles. And now it helps me accept tribulation, to love tribulation. You know, to be able to go through it more peaceful than I did before.
So. Nah, I don't want my relationship to be like the stock market.
Mm.
Up and down, up and down.
Yeah.
I want my relationship to go one direction.
All the way up.
Up. And the difference between adversity and immoral behavior is adversity, although it may hurt, at the end of the day, it's going to lead you in an up direction.
Right.
Whereas immoral behavior, although it may be pleasurable for one person or whatever, boom, it's only going one direction.
Yeah. And you can, and there's a lot of people that are in immoral behavior relationship, and you know, they're fake happy.
Right. Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Like, if you are internally, now I might not be able to see it, but if you are internally fake happy, red flag.
Right.
Red flag. You should be externally happy, and more, your happiness should be more internal than, you know, external.
Exactly.
You know, I can have a straight, probably a nasty look on my face, but be at so much peace.
Right.
You know, and you just would never know it because I won't express, you know, just how at peace I am and where I'm at relationship-wise. Because I know for us, with everything that we've been through, you know, all the adversity that we went through, the odds were really stacked against us.
Right.
If you look at statistics on why people divorce,
yeah.
We're really, I mean, I hate to say it like this because I truly believe in God, but really on paper, we're not even supposed to be together right now.
Right.
We got married young. We suffered financially to the point where we were homeless, sharing sandwiches, lights cut off sometimes. I mean, everything that you can think of, we've been through.
Right.
And there's grown people that can't go through that.
Right.
And I want people in our generation to see that and say, hey, this young couple did it. I can do it too.
Right.
Don't get up and leave every time adversity comes. Understand adversity versus immoral, intolerable.
Right.
Do you have any final words? Except that you love me so much.
As I just said, like, adversity, regular adversity, is only going to make you stronger. So, like you said, it's nothing to leave about.
Right.
It's nothing to separate or divorce about. Embrace it.
Yes, love it.
Rejoice in tribulation. Tribulation will make you patient. And patience will give you experience,
mm-hmm.
and experience will give you hope.
Hope.
And as long as you have hope, you can go on.
Yes. So that's all we have for you guys tonight. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you will tune in 2 weeks from now as we continue Dinner Rolls and
Convo. What is that?
Yes. What?
Peace.
Just because you had, I know you better come down here and eat this sandwich.
Oh.
Yeah. Bye, guys.